Kia ora from New Zealand. In fact, we're in Wellington, Victoria University. And what I'd like to do today is follow up with a whole bunch of questions that people came up with about the mystery of the Boulder Bank in Nelson. And so I've come here to Wellington today to speak with Warren Dickenson, who has for many years researched the Nelson Boulder Bank and many other similar features in coastlines in New Zealand and elsewhere. So, Warren, thanks heaps for your time right now. I'm looking forward to finding out what you think about some of the suggestions people have made with this video. And we'll go through them, if you like, one by one, some of the different points people have suggested.
Yep, that sounds good.
And then you see what you think. So it's really a fantastic opportunity to have the expert giving some comments and feedback about this mystery. Because number one is, it's still a bit of a mystery, isn't it?
It is. And I think I'm only an expert because I've looked at it probably more than other people have. And you make observations along the way, and I've been working on it for perhaps 30 years. So I have some ideas about it.
Brilliant. Okay. Here's number one. So a lot of people have made this point, which is that the Boulder Bank looks man-made. How do we know that it isn't? Or is it, in fact, man-made?
When I first saw it, I looked across at it from the road, and I thought, oh, that's a man-made structure. And I actually went out and looked at it, and as soon as you get out there and look at it, you realize it's not man-made. But I think the best observation here is to look at a sketch from Charles Heafy in 1841 showing that the Boulder Bank was alive and well in 1840 before the Pakehau really came, and I don't think the Maori had the technology at that time to build some structure like that. So we can say that it was here before 1841. It's not man-made.
So there have been a couple of suggestions that it might be related to earthquakes and tsunamis. Is there some possibility that that's the case?
Yes. Well, earthquakes and tsunamis are kind of one-off events. And if they do occur, it's possible to build up some deposits. You can see the helter-skelter and the chaos of the deposit left behind. We don't really find this in Nelson Boulder Bank. The boulders and pebbles on the Boulder Bank are all very nicely sorted. They're all about the same size, and we don't find all this debris. Plus, we don't find any evidence for debris behind the Boulder Bank, and I think it's pretty safe to say that we probably didn't make these by earthquakes or tsunamis.
So it's not the debris from some sort of earthquake or tsunami. Okay. Is it possibly a glacial moraine?
So all the boulders on the Boulder Bank are the Cable Bay granite diorite. If you had either a glacier or rivers, you'd expect to have deposits, or you expect to have a variety of different types of rock, not just from one type of rock. And plus the fact that there's no evidence for any glaciation in the recent past in the Nelson area.
Okay, certainly not at sea level anyway.
Not at sea level, correct. There are glaciers higher up in the mountains, but they never made it down even close to sea level.
So that's a bit of a unfortunate, because I quite like that one. Now, those are three easy questions.
Right.
Should we go to something a little bit more complex?
We can indeed.
We had a couple of questions from someone saying it looks very similar to Chesil Beach, which is a long beach sort of spit in the UK. Do you know about Chesil Beach?
Yes, I had the good fortune to visit Chesil Beach a couple years ago. It looks like the Boulder Bank, and you can see that from the air. You say, oh, that looks much like the Boulder Bank. It's a long spit. In fact, Chesil Beach is about 13 kilometers long. But when you look at it up close, you can see that it's made up of a lot of smaller pebbles, but nothing anywhere near the size of the boulders on the Boulder Bank in Nelson. And these are all easily moved by waves. Here we can see the Boulder Bank at Nelson, and you can see that to the left there are cobbles and boulders. And going up the shore here, we can see that it graduates into pebbles of about the same size as the ones on Chesil Beach. If you happen to see the Nelson Boulder Bank at high tide, you would only see the Pebble Ridge. If you see the Nelson Boulder Bank at low tide, you would see the Pebble Ridge plus the big boulders on the boulder platform down below mean tide level.
Okay, and then I have another question, which is, how far out do these boulders go, as far as we know, out to sea?
Well, they go out at least a kilometer where they become buried by Tasman Bay muds.
So it could even be further than that?
It could be. In fact, they probably are underneath the muds.
Right, okay.
As many of you know, the boulder bank has always been thought to have formed by longshore drift. The way longshore drift works, if the waves hit the coastline at an oblique angle, they will pick a particle up and move it in that direction as well, sort of down drift, and they'll toss it up on top of the ridge. And then what happens to happen, in order to get that particle back down into the swash zone, you need to have backwash of the waves. And what generally happens in gravel beaches is that the water percolates down into the ridge very quickly and it loses all its energy. So there's very little energy to pull that particle back down into the wave zone. Once it's back down in the wave zone, then it can move it back up in the direction of the longshore drift. And there's no question that the waves can wash large boulders and cobbles up on top of the Pebble Ridge, but it's getting them back down, back into the wave zone, that is the problem. In other words, the backswash is very low energy. One possible idea that's been put forward is that once these boulders sit on top of the gravel ridge, that they are on loose pebbles and loose gravels, that the boulder might just slide back down by gravity. In actual fact, it might be a very minor process, but it's never really been documented. So making this process continuous is probably not enough to move the big boulders laterally alongshore the drift.
Now, what more can you tell us about these boulders? Is there anything else that we need to know?
This picture shows essentially what's below the large boulders at Nelson. We have a very poorly sorted pile of rounded rocks below the large boulders on the surface.
And in that poorly sorted material, are there boulders also?
Yes, there are. And we found very large boulders, such as this 2-meter roller, which was somewhere in this big pile of poorly sorted debris. You can see that the boulders are actually sort of a lag on the surface. In other words, they're left behind. As the waves are eroding this whole lower feature, some of the larger boulders come to the surface and they provide, if you will, a kind of an armor.
Okay, and so that armor of boulders is what's left behind. The smaller pebbles have been picked up, thrown up on the boulder bank, and are behaving a bit like Chesil Beach. But the other stuff left behind still has had to have got there somehow, and that's the mystery. Is that correct?
I think you said it better than I can. And it's this boulder bank deposit which gives rise to the boulder bank, which I find is the big mystery. And how that deposit got there, we really don't understand it that well.
So one of our questions was, I thought a very good one, which was, is it a possibility, even hypothetically, that there's an outcrop of granodiorite parallel to the boulder bank, and that by perhaps a fault line has down thrown the outcrop? It's now been eroded away, which was the source of all those boulders extending along the length.
Yes, that's an incredibly interesting observation and a very good question. And so if there is bedrock, it's quite deep. I'd have to say, in my way of thinking, that would be my answer to the origin of the boulder bank. But again, we're lacking concrete evidence on this. What I can say, though, is that all the sedimentological evidence points to something like that.
Is there a way you could use some technique to dig deeper underneath the platform of boulders to find out what's there?
Yes, what you could do is put a little drill rig offshore, perhaps 500 meters, and start drilling. And you would be looking for granodiorite. You could actually drill a series of holes starting sort of at the top of the boulder bank and then make a proper cross-section through the boulder bank offshore. But drilling is really expensive, and I'm not sure the good citizens of Nelson would like to see a drill rig out there.
Don't you think we should crowdsource a drill rig?
Well, now that would be quite interesting.
Only a few million bucks.
That would be very interesting. I don't think it would cost several million. It might just cost a million. Nothing for crowdsourcing, though.
That's right. If you're out there, everybody, you know, maybe put a suggestion to think whether it'd be worth the effort. Sometimes a mystery is almost more interesting than the actual answer. It kind of, when it finally gets revealed, it sort of kills the journey.
It does kill the journey. The processes that have made the Boulder Bank deposit are very difficult to envision and difficult to find around the world.